¿Por dónde se entra? ¿Por aquí?
No sé.
Hi.
Julie, have a nice time.
Thomas Andrews, she started out. The Mons.
1905.
1913.
came in here the day after my 14th birthday. Harlan and Wolf. That's where you worked in Belfast. My dad got me my start. Then my brothers after me. You could hear the noise from where we lived, but nothing prepared you for the size of the place. They put me to work in 401. That's what we called her. We knew she'd be the largest passenger ship in the world, but we didn't call her Titanic then.
I was there from the beginning. I watched the ship race lay the keel blocks. They set big wooden blocks on the slipway to start with, then the keel at top of it, like a backbone, and the frames attached to that, like a skeleton. Workshops everywhere. It took weeks to find your way around. There'd be workshops for every trade you ever heard of. Painters, sailmakers, coppersmiths, boiler makers, cabinet makers. I even learned a bit about French polishing off them.
Harlot Roof was a fine place to work, but dangerous. Every ship cost a life, and there'd be lots of injuries besides.
I was in the engine works for a while. Very well equipped it was. That's where we built the triple expansion engines. Two of them, each as high as a three-story house.
I worked in the frame bending shop. We had heat steel beams in the furnace, then hooked them onto slabs of cast iron and hammer them curved. It was skilled work. You had to bend them more than you needed because the frame straightened out a little when it cooled.
The shell plates that made up the hull weighed up to 4.5 tons. They were taller than the dad.
The plates were overlapped on the edges. Some were raised, one after another. We called it clencher. One of the foremen told me years ago, that's how you built steel ships.
I worked as a heater boy. You had to heat the rivets on a wee plate. You pump the bellows till the rivet was white hot. Then you get a hold of it with your tongs and throw it up to the catcher. And he put it in the hole in the plate for the holder up. There were two of us on the other side of the plate for the holder up. We had to hammer the rivet so it filled the hole before it turned dull red. The double bottom. That's a wee space we called the tanks, made up of steel plates. The rest of the rivet squad all had to fit into that gap. One of the foremen would check each rivet with a special hammer. If it made a ringing sound, we'd have to get back and chase it out after work. I'd get scared working down in that double bottom. You only had candles for light. And the constant hammering against the shell plates. You could hear it all over Belfast. Some of those boys ended up stone deaf, so they did. We were paid 31 bob a week. The heater boy and catcher got 16 bob. But we all worked the same 54 hours.
The upper deck was steel too, and part of the strength of the ship. There's no straight lines in a ship. And when you look down the weather deck, you could see the sheer of her hull, which stopped her flexing at sea.
The stern frame had to be strong enough to take the rudder turning in heavy seas. You'd have all these timbers and guy wires to steady the frame, and men scurrying around like ants underneath. When we came to launch day, I was torn between pride and fear. The standing ways were coated in tallow, train oil and soft soap. So the ship would slide when they shifted her weight off the blocks. That was the most dangerous part. And the shipwrights were knocking away the last props. They were under compression, you see, and the sliding ways would be released by the hydraulic trigger. 100,000 people watched the launch. Some paid a bob to sit in the reserved seating. There were extra trams laid on. Then we all went off to the pub to wish her well.
Doc, you were proud to be an island man that day. And Titanic was the pride of Belfast.
Thank you for joining us. The tour will end in a few seconds.
Thank you. And missed the departure. At noon on April 10th, bang on time, and fully expecting to be in New York within a few days, the Titanic sounded her whistle and cast off her lines.
Liner described by the Warsaw Line as a queen of the ocean. By March 1912, the Titanic was ready for
thank you. last menu.
Probably why he was sent up from second class. Or Johnson, going the other way. Sit down.
I bring you to the room forward and a quick look down the long stairway that led from the boat deck 3 or 4 decks down. Frankly, I'm never likely to forget the sight of that cold, greenish water creeping step by step up that stairway.
The ship was now sinking fast, but the crowds on deck were quite calm. Our whole trouble was in getting away as quickly as possible, otherwise our boat would be pulled down with the ship. During all this time, the ship's piano was kept playing and the strains of Nero my Gartery could be plainly heard as the sound of the great ship was raised in the air.
A bit later, the foreign funnel guy is carried away, and the funnel, weighing perhaps 50 or 60 tons, bound down with a crash on the water.
Saturday, I thought we were just going to be dumped into the water. We had one of the worst times for that boat to be lowered. And I had the baby's crying all night, so frankly, we touched the water and we were rowing. There was a light in the distance, and the captain said, "Now, then."
Slowly, you reared up on end, till at last it was absolutely perpendicular. Then, quietly, but quicker and quicker, she seemed just to slide away over the surface and disappear.
Abajo en el suelo. Sí, ya me lo he visto. Oh, ya.
¿Cuánto vale?
4 libras.
Rampla.
Aunque no sé cuál me gusta. ¿Cuál te gusta más?
Aquí tienes los peluches.
Ya, pero eso le he comprado ya.
Ya.
Pero eso que es para colgar.
Sí. Pequeñitas.
Thank you.
Este sí que me lo cojo para el árbol.
¿Cuál es?
5 libras.
Yo para el árbol no, pues es que lo
he ¿El qué?
La otra bola que me compran, que no me apetece tanto. Pero no había unos cacharros que eran como en plan antiguo.
Sí, haz la cola.